Okay, thank you everyone. I'm glad that you're still here and that you have some energy left for the last two talks. I'm starting this slide with empty. That's because I want to ask you something first. The next slide will have a riddle on it. And I want to ask you, if you already know this one, please don't shout the answer out loud. Just let everyone try and figure this out by themselves. So be quiet. Well, it's a bit depressing, though. I hope you can read it, but a father and his son are in a car accident, and the father dies at the scene, and the son, badly injured, is rushed to the hospital. In the operating room, the surgeon looks at the boy and says, "I can't operate on this boy, he's my son." So, just read it, and I'll give you 10 seconds. I'm not giving you the answer. Oh, you're super quiet. That's nice. Okay, well, my name is Lieke. I'm from Amsterdam, the Netherlands, and I noticed that there are lots of cat pictures at this conference, so I added one. I thought, yeah, it's a black cat cycling through Amsterdam on an orange bike with tulips. What more do you want? So, yeah. Well, you probably know me from Real Skills, maybe, maybe not. I'm involved in the Real Skills Summer of Code. I'm also a Dutch ambassador for the European Code Week. If you don't know it, just Google it and participate, because it's awesome. I also have my own website called codepancake.com, where you can find a lot of resources on coding. And I'm a bit proud of the Spotlight series. I have to mention it, because there are lots of interviews with some amazing women in tech. So you should check it out. I work at VHCO. It's a national expert organization on girls, women, and science and technology. Our mission is to increase the involvement of women and girls in science, technology, engineering, mathematics, and IT. We do a lot of research, but also we organize activities throughout the educational chain, so primary, secondary, and higher education. And you can see three of our role models. We have a large database with over 2,000 female IT and STEM professionals and students. And I think that's amazing, because we can always count on them if we have activities. But the question is, why are we doing this? Why do we need more women in tech? Well, I think Brenna already mentioned it a bit, but diversity. Teams with more gender diversity have proven to be more creative, innovative, and effective teams. If you're interested in this topic, I just go online. There are lots of resources online. Another thing, there's the lack of women entering the tech field is also a loss of talent for the IT industry and a loss of opportunity for the women entering the job market. So a lot of talent is wasted, actually. Girls and females are underrepresented in tech if you compare them to their male counterparts. And in the Netherlands, it's somewhat exceptional because we are last. Or actually, Tunisia is below us, and then it's the Netherlands. Less than 10% of the females are working in IT in the Netherlands. And you can see Germany is below average, but it's 35, and we have 23%. And the average of the European Union is 37. So why is this? Well, the choice for science and technology by Dutch girls is far below the average, like I said. Well, it is true that brains of boys and girls are not the same, but these differences is not the reason why there are many more boys choosing a career in tech, because both of the brains are full with potential, but to what extent the potential is fulfilled and which talents it develops is highly dependent on the stimulation that parents and teachers offer. Next to that, it's also that girls think they perform worse than they actually do in STEM-related subjects. I'm not sure what your grading system is, but in the Netherlands, it's from 1 to 10. And if you have a 5.5, then you're past your exams. We always ask our students if they think they're good in mathematics, and boys normally raise their hands if they have a 6, because, you know, it's good, they passed our test, right? And girls are more like, no, I should have an 8 or a 9. So they're a bit too hard on themselves, and it's not necessary at all. Second, the environment. Like I said, girls are less stimulated by teachers and parents to choose a career in IT. And this is a cartoon, and I don't think you can read it, but it's a teacher. And he says, well, your child has very good grades in mathematics and science, but yeah, she's a girl. And then the parents reply, oh shit, that's too bad. So that's not an option to consider a career in IT. Last but not least is unfamiliarity. Girls have no good image of STEM education and professions, and there's a huge lack of role models. So I just want to conclude this with a quote. It's from Unlocking the Clubhouse. Very early in life, computing is claimed as male territory. At each step in early childhood through college, computing is both actively claimed as guy stuff by boys and men and passively seeded by girls and women. Careful observation shows that disinterest and dissatisfaction are neither genetic nor accidental nor inherent to the field, but are the bitter fruit of many external influences. And this is important, because if you think that there are less girls in IT because of disinterest, then you're wrong. One of these external influences is unconscious bias. Evolution has taught us to automatically process information without critical thinking. So we're constantly overlooking much of the world around us, and there's actually nothing mysterious about this. We receive 11 million of bits of information every day, and we can only consciously process 40 bits. The conclusion is stuff gets broken while our brain is storing information, and our objectivity is certainly clouded, because our brain is taking shortcuts and it relies on our earlier assumptions. So even a tiny bit of bias can have big consequences. For example, these biases can prevent the introduction of diversity into workplaces. I think this is a great example, blind auditions. You know, I just added another picture of a cat behind the curtain, because that's the way it's supposed to be. Well, it's a research from Princeton, and they found out that since the 1970s, the number of women in orchestras went up from 5% to 25%, and due to the fact that they asked them to audition behind the screen or a curtain, so they couldn't see if it was a male or a female. So I think that's a lot of biasing going on around there. Well, most people would agree that gender bias exists in others. All of us, myself included, are biased, so you should take a look around. I think you know this cartoon, maybe. A guy who says, well, you suck at math, and then a girl has the answer wrong, and it's like, girls suck at math. Well, if you're curious about your own biases, you can take the implicit associations test. It's called Project Implicit. It's from Harvard University. And it measures actually how quickly words like math and physics are associated with boy or man. You can also take this test with career and family, but this is a gender science test. And I took it, and I have to be honest, I worked in IT, I've been a developer, and these were my results. So it says, your data suggests a strong automatic association of male with science and female with liberal arts. So yeah, I just added a gif in it because, you know, that's also something you should do. And I felt terrible because I worked in IT and I should have known better, right? So this is something I should take home. Now it gets me back to the riddle. I think you know the answer by now, probably, I hope. So who is the surgeon? You can shout. Yeah, the mother, it is true. Actually, 2 days ago, I learned that in German, surgeon is a female word. So it could be that most of you already know the answer right away. I don't know. But in English and Dutch, it's different. In 80% of the times when we ask or tell people about this riddle, they don't know the answer. Or they are more likely to think that it's a gay couple, or that the father is a stepfather, or that he magically lives again, before we think that it's the mother. And this is true. And I have to admit, I had it wrong the first time. So don't feel bad about it. Don't feel bad about being biased, because it's just it's just because of our culture that we're biased. So, no, this is not about football. But, yeah, when it comes to implicit and explicit associations, the Netherlands are highest in gender stereotyping, because a lot of, I think a couple million of people took the test and you could fill in your country, and these were the results. And I think that's shocking, because I always think of the Netherlands as modern and open-minded, and it turns out it's quite, we are quite old-fashioned when it comes to gender stereotyping. So I was shocked and I decided to take a look around and I noticed some things. I think you all know the girl and boy department at toy stores, yeah. Well, on the left it's pink, it's an advertisement for girls, meisjes, so you learn a bit of Dutch now. And on the right it's jongens, it's boys, it's blue. And this is actually for the girls, it's a dishwashing set. I don't know why, it's a stupid gift anyway, because nobody likes doing the dishes, right? But yeah. It is pink, it has a pink sink, it has a real working tap, it's like amazing. And on the right, it's for boys, it's a microscope, it has 23 parts. It has bottles, glasses, everything. So these are associations, and you come across them when you're already 3 years old or something. This is another one, it's also in Dutch. It's from a children's magazine. It's a test, and it defines who you are. And on the left, it's for boys, of course, because it's blue. It says, what are you? Well, the results are you are a tough guy, you are a smart guy, or you are a funny guy. And on the right, it's pink and it's for girls. And it says, you are a sweet girl. And the description is horrible. It says, you think about others before you think about yourself. That's amazing. Okay. Second, well, you're a sporty girl. And third, you are gezellig. Gezellig is non-translatable. But it means something like cozy, fun to be around with. I think it's a bit like the German word gemütlich, if I pronounce it right. Gesellig? Ah, okay, well. Anyway, I think this gender bias could be a major threat, and it is a major threat, because it's one of the key reasons why few girls study computer science. The good news is bias can be weakened. The bad news is you cannot do it alone. We all should do this together. So, what should we do first? Well, be aware that you're biased, because believe me, you are. Just take the test when you have time, and then you learn about your biases and how you can address them. And second, I think it's important, use inclusive language. Because a couple weeks ago, I was at a conference, a Dutch conference, and it was about the future programmer. And someone got to the stage and started talking about the future programmer, and he said, well, he is this, and he is that, and he is, should be this, and he should be like this. And I felt offended, come on. I'm obviously not a future programmer then. So I don't think he meant it that way, but it's good to be aware of what you're saying. I think this is from a social media platform, and they removed the word hacker from their job titles, and they noticed a change in who was applying. So they decided to write an article about it and how gender inclusive they were. They attached an email they sent to the employees, and the email started with, "Hi guys." It's not very gender inclusive, so just for some people, this is offending, so just be aware of what you're saying. Well, this is important. If you're male or female, doesn't matter. Hold yourself and others accountable and point it out. Because by the simple act of talking openly about behavioral patterns, it makes the subconscious conscious. So talking can transform minds, which can transform behaviors, which can transform communities, which can result in a better environment, for example, women in tech. So we should all share this and talk about it. Last but not least, use your imagination. Counter-program your brain. I googled for a programmer, and these were the results I got. I really like the right one below. It says, do not wake up a programmer. He is working, not sleeping. it's important lesson. But you can only see one female and there's a black guy and the rest of them are all white males. And I think you should be aware of the images you have in your head. If I ask you to picture an architect or a programmer, I think most of the time it will be a white male with glasses or something like that. Just be aware that this is not always true. And I think you probably all know this one. Hashtag I look like an engineer. I think this is a great way of bias busting. It started with Isis, she's a girl. She works at One Login, and I don't know if I'm supposed to say that, but she was in an advertising campaign for her company, and they were looking for developers, and then she got a lot of responses on her picture, like, oh, I didn't know that you were an engineer. You don't look like an engineer, and so on and so on. And she was a bit fed up with this and started the hashtag, actually, and she asked everyone to spread the word. And I think these are all engineers you should remember. And this is some great gender, this is some great bias busting, like I said, and it's a great way of breaking down gender stereotypes. So in short, be aware of that you're biased. Use inclusive language, hold yourself and others accountable, and use your imagination. So counter-program your brain. I know that we are at JSConf, and it should be about coding and programming. But the thing is, it's not about programming, it's about the way you are programmed. So I know it's been a challenging day today, but I would like to ask you to take this home and to look past your initial perceptions. Because I bet you they're probably wrong. So thank you.